Did y'all hear that scripture reading at all? Like, did you hear it? You got the point. There's this large crowd, and they come to Jesus, and the first thing he says is, hey, you don't hate everyone. It's kind of pointless. You shouldn't really be here. Could you imagine a preacher who gets up and says, hey, you know, if you're not willing to give up everything, to hate everything in your life, and trade all of it for Jesus, leave. Now, if Jesus was the preacher, obviously that is exactly what he did. And he did it more than once. Once he gets up and he says this, and the other time he gets up and he says something completely different. But pretty much the same point. He tells them a parable of the seeds. Some fell on the rocky soil. Some fell among thorns. Some fell on the path. Some on fertile soil. And then he leaves. Now he has this huge crowd and he has this opportunity to tell them anything he wants to tell them. And he tells them a parable. He goes back to his disciples and they say, you know they have no clue what you just said. And he said, I speak in parables so they won't hear. So they won't understand. This Christ who understands the very nature of things being more than what they appear to be. This Christ who understands that you may have a box. It's a box. Wife did a good job. It's better than I would do, so don't worry. I mean, if Wayne had made it, it'd have square corners, but they're close. But we have a box, and the idea of a box is great. I mean, we do. We have limits and perimeters and heights and widths and lengths. But the problem with a box is it's completely external. You have no clue about this box. There's a really great way to test a box, though. I just really wanted to have fun this morning. That's why we have this analogy. There's a great way to test a box. Anybody know that way to test a good box? What? I heard it whispered quietly. What was it? Step on it! Oh! Well, made it look like a box. Even step on the boot. The truth is, you do not know a box until it's tested. The problem with what I say here is I say Church of Christ versus discipleship. And this is what I want you to get. A Church of Christ is a group of people. And too often we get into this and we will say, I am a group of people. Unless you're possessed by demons named Legion, you are not a group of people. The only way you are a group of people would be if you have crazy possession going on. You might be two, you and the Holy Spirit, that's two. But you're never going to be a group of people. But he doesn't say that. He doesn't say it. He doesn't even act like the Church of Christ. I learned my training well. You actually try to get people to church. Remarkable concept. It's brand new. We're going to try it. And you actually reach out and you say things like, I want you to come and just be amongst us. And what happens is you have a country club. You have a membership concept of, I go to the Church of Christ. I belong to the Church of Christ. And then it takes on this meaning that it never meant. Because he doesn't say that, does he? They don't come in and says, do you want to be part of my church? Not even a question Jesus ever asked. The only question he asked is, if you want to be my disciple, let me not even ask you a question. If you want to be my disciple, you want to follow Christ, who do you hate? What if today your mama comes and says to you, I will disown you if you follow Jesus? You say, I've already decided that. I'm a disciple of Christ. Your papa comes to you and says, I will disown you if you follow Christ. You say, I'm a disciple. That means I've already decided that. When God does things in your life and you think that you think that something belongs to you. You have a right to something. You have a right to whatever you complain about. Whatever you gripe about, whatever you get angry at God at, whatever you get angry at the church at, all of that stuff wrapped into one, Christ said you've already hated if you were his disciple. And it no longer becomes a matter of in the moment, what do you do? It no longer becomes a matter of rules, because honestly, I can't make a rule and enforce something in your head. The thought police are not effective yet. We're working on it. But he says these crazy commands that are impossible to enforce. Hate. And what he means by that is he wants you to hate them. He doesn't soften this and say, well, I want you to dislike them more than me. He says, hate them. When it comes in comparison to the gospel, when it comes into following me, you already hate them. Honestly, you tell me I don't need to see my enemy, I say thank you. I don't have to face that person who annoys the tar out of me, I say thank you. And when Christ says, hey, you need to leave mother and father, I'm like, hey, I've got that one covered. Whew, thank you. And instead of it being, God, you've taken this from me, no, thank you. I didn't want it. I wanted to be your disciple instead. Today we're going to continue with this thought in 2 Corinthians 13. Because Paul comes out and he says something that, you know what, Paul's not a very good preacher either. Look. 2 Corinthians 13, starting in verse 1. This is the third time I am coming to you. Every fact is to be confirmed by the testimony of two or three witnesses. I previously said when present the second time, and though now absent, I say in advance, to those who have sinned in the past, and to all the rest as well, that if I come again, I will not spare anyone. Since you are seeking for proof of the Christ who speaks in me, and who is not weak towards you, but mighty in you. For indeed he was crucified because of weakness, yet he lives because of the power of God. For we are also weak in him, yet we will live with him because of the power of God directed towards you. So imagine, you see what he's saying there? He's saying, I'm going to come to you like Christ did. Our example, our apostle that we love so much because he writes most of the Bible, we get excited about Paul. And we're like, and what does he say? He says, I'm coming to you like Christ would. And our first thought is, oh, that'd be nice. You know, Christ would show up. That'd be great. We like Christ. We like Christ at a distance. We don't actually say we want Christ to show up. Because this is not directed at them and saying, hey, you're doing a great job, but I'm going to come to you like Christ would. No. He's saying, y'all are really messing up. I'm going to come to you like Christ. I'm going to come to you without sparing anything. I'm going to come to you with a truth that is going to hit you very, very hard. In being weak like Christ, we find the power of Christ in which he spoke in a way that makes me uncomfortable. But he makes a true point. Paul continues with this. He says what to do instead of this. He gives an alternative. He does. I can come to you in the power of Christ. I can come to you in the words of Christ. Or, verse 5, test yourselves to see if you are in the faith. Examine yourselves. Or do you not recognize this about yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you fail the test? But I trust that you will realize that we ourselves do not fail the test. Now we pray to God that you do no wrong, not that we ourselves may appear approved, but that you may do what is right, even though we may appear unapproved. For we can do nothing against the truth, but only for the truth. For we rejoice when we ourselves are weak, but you are strong. This we also pray for, that you be made complete. For this reason I am writing these things while absent, so that when I present, I need not use severity. In accordance with the authority which the Lord gave me for building up and not for tearing down. He says that you can test yourself. You could actually examine yourself. You could do it. He says, and then you know what? And I could talk to you like this at a distance, and it'd be great, and I would never have to come to you in the spirit of Christ and telling you how terrible you are. It's up to you, though. I mean, it's your option. You just examine yourself. Because in all this, we can look at Paul and we can say, isn't that kind of harsh? But I would much rather face up with what is in me now. I would rather face up what I'm really made of today than to come to God with my mask on and Him to rip that thing off and go, this was what was underneath. This is what you called serving me. I want to get to heaven and God be like, I know it took a lot of people to beat you up, but I'm glad they did. I'm glad that you're here and I can say, well done. Because of the people who beat you up to the point I can say that. Those people who didn't say, you know, one, okay, good job, you're going to church, great job. You sat in the pew, excellent job. It's not even in the list. It's like the fruits of the Spirit sitting effectively. And he says that, he says this power, this authority that the church has. It's meant to build us up. But he doesn't take away the fact that there's a time for it to tear us down. And I don't mean tear us down as a body. That's why I tried to get away from the Church of Christ big concept and get on to discipleship individual. But how many of us come to the country club on Sunday? How many of us come here and complain about something? I'll give you my list. I examined myself to kind of see how bad I was. I figured I should follow the scripture first to see how bad an F I can get. I think I got a 12. I come here, and one of the first things I think of is, at a country club, I want the right temperature. But I have no body fat, so I think everything is cold. And every Sunday, like, it's freezing in here. And everybody else is like, it's a little warm. No, it's cold. And then I think about the food, and in this we have, you know, the communion, and it's unsalted. I hope you know it's unsalted. Even the Old Testament, they always got salt with their food. You couldn't give a Levitical priest bread without salt. That's weird. Bible says, no offering without salt. And I'm like, it doesn't have salt. And I complain about something that you may have heard. Music. I don't like acapella. No, I don't enjoy it. It's not like I get in my car and I go, let's play acapella or let's play pentatonics. I'm like, let's play the loudest bass line I can. What hits so loud that my ears start to hurt? I mean, that's me. I'm just jamming out of my car and people are staring at me going, he's special. He's real special. He knows people can see him, right? That's how I jam out of my car, trust me. But the thing is, and I was getting in this habit and I was going, I really like that. That's how I jam out. I'm so pumped up for a sermon some days, and I don't need nothing. Some days I get up and I'm like, God, I need a baseline right now. Just give me something. Get me pumped. Get me on fire. Let me go. I want to feel something today. Sometimes I need that little boost. And then I realized what it had become. A country club. Church had become a country club. And what it was I was so concerned about all those little comforts. All those little things. And I said, God, how can I even worship you in the middle of this? And God took me to a verse that I hate probably today more than I will the rest of the year. The verse where God tells us that I can't have anything. I can't keep anything close to my heart. I can't have anything in my life that would compete with Him. I can't expect things and then get angry when I don't get it. I can't get angry with God
It's because it didn't do it my way. Saturday, I was out here in the parking lot, laying down in the parking lot. It doesn't make a lot of sense. Don't speed through here, please. And I was just laying down in the parking lot, just fighting with God. More than any day of the year, I was fighting with God. It got a little crazy. And I was yelling and I was screaming, but it was in a parking lot, no one can hear us. And I was angry at God. Because I thought God should give me what I wanted. We're going to finish with this last section of Scripture, 11 through 14. Finally, brethren, rejoice. Oh, I love that. Be made complete. Be comforted. Be like-minded. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. So one of those that I'm going to tell you is impossible. There are commands in the Bible and I want you to get that they are impossible to do. And I don't mean impossible as God can't do them. I mean impossible as we can't do them. I mean, as in the middle of everything, if God is telling you to rejoice, can you do it? No! It is not in our power. We can build these beautiful walls, we can make everything look nice, but at the end of the day, if there's no power in it, it's pointless. It's just crumpled up paper, it's worth to throw it away. And discipleship is what we should be seeking. But discipleship is terrible. Every Sunday we get here and we tell you how great it is to serve God. But discipleship is terrible. It is terrible because Christ said it was terrible. And for no other reason, just because he said so. And because every time that Jesus gets this big crowd, he sends them away. Or he insults them and he says, you're just here for food. Quit working for food. And he left. Went up to a mountain and prayed. We get a crowd of 5,000 people and the first thing we think is God is doing great and Jesus is thinking, send them away. He gets 7,000 people, he feeds them and then go hides on a mountain. Tries to escape in a boat. They chase him around the lake. This is the story of Scripture. This is the story of Christ because you know what he's saying? Discipleship is not easy. It is not churchianity. It is something completely different where you say that you belong to God. And if I show up here and I don't have a baseline, okay. If I show up here and there's no salt in the crackers, okay. If I show up here and it's cold, I'll shiver, but be okay. And I decide ahead of time that I don't get to complain about anything. I don't care what we complain about because we don't get to. Because we are so accustomed to a building that shelters us from everything. And yet, that's not Christianity. Christianity says, why don't you go to those people? Those people with nothing. Those people that are suffering. Those people that smell funny.
Oh, wait, we've got a nice village.
But that's not discipleship. Discipleship means that Jesus is our teacher. Means that Jesus is the center of our life in a way that everything else is on a level playing field. And that's what he demanded. And it's going to take some work for us to become disciples.
Because honestly, at times I've become a church of Christ. Plural for the singular. God, it's really confusing. And I realize that I don't need to be, okay, I'm part of a group. I need to say, not that I'm part of a group, that's not my description. My description is I'm a disciple. My description is that I belong to Christ. It's not we. There's no plural. I can't even speak for you. You may all hate God. I can't prove otherwise. And we're so caught up in this we that it's going to take us some time to go, where am I? Am I willing to say the things that Christ demanded of him? When this excited young man comes up to Christ and he says, I want to follow you, and he goes, well, foxes have holes, birds have nests, I ain't got no place to lay my head. Jesus, he wants to follow you. Yeah, I ain't got no place to lay my head. But when this rich young man comes to him and he knows his heart, and he's talking about doing the right thing and teaching the truth, and Jesus said, okay, sweet, you want some treasure in heaven too? Yeah? Go sell everything. And the rich man went away. Christianity needs to come back to this. Me wanting to be a disciple. All of us wanting to be a disciple more than griping about our country club. More than complaining about every little nook and cranny, because this is about me complaining all week long. But it fits all of us. And if there's one of you who says you don't complain about anything, you're either lying or you don't actually talk. It's an option. You might be a mute, therefore you never complain. Got it. It works. The truth is, this is about us and all of us. As individuals, though, each of us considering something and going, God, is it okay if I show up to church and the heater is broken, the lights are all out, they killed the power, there's a tornado going on, lightning's flashing, and it's just a terrible day to worship God. And we say, so, it's 100 degrees in that building, so, it's raining, so, and we sit there and we say, God, I'm going to follow you, and it's not about me getting my way, it's not about everything being exactly what I want, it's about everything being exactly what you want from me. Because if he's telling you to hate your mother and father, brother, sister, son, daughter, I mean, I hate cold. I mean, and just the level. Putting things on a realistic level and thinking about things fairly and saying, really, is it being 2 degrees too hot in your problem? No. Is it doing being 2 degrees too cold in your problem? No. Is it a problem if I'm not willing to give that to God? Yes. If I'm griping and complaining when he tells me do everything, that includes everything I've talked about, right? Everything. Does that include everything? Come on, it's easy. Test it. Yes, it does. If there's something you're complaining about and Christ says do everything without griping or complaining, did he include what you griped and complained about? Yes. So, I know many in this church are very excited about where this church is going. But we need to remember that it takes me being a disciple first. It takes all of us being disciples first. And keeping things where they need to be. Today we offer an invitation. Something Christ had no success with. They all deserved him. But yet he continued to offer that. At the point he was rejected by everyone, he
offered up himself. We've had this theme. I don't want you to read it. I don't want to read it to you. I want you to read it. And I want you to focus when it says, work out your own salvation. Because in a body of Christians, there's only one person you know is a Christian. That's you. You're the only one who knows if you are right with God. You are the only one who knows if God comes back tonight, what he's going to say to you. And you need to consider that after everyone deserts Christ, he still wants you back. You are not too bad or too good to need Christ. Today we offer that invitation that you can believe that Jesus is Lord. Repent, because we have failed him terribly. Confess Jesus as your Lord, making him your Lord and your disciple. Be baptized into him, his death, clothing yourself with Christ, raised to live a new life, so that when he comes back, you're not worried about what he's going to say. You already know. You already know when you get there, he's going to go, you're covered in the blood. Or if there's anybody who, honestly, you need to get right, there's something that you've held on to that sin and you know it's fighting with God, and you can only have one Lord. Or if there's anybody who needs prayers, or you wish to submit to the eldership, please come now as we stand, as we sing.